As many of you may know, I'm a lover of historical mysteries. My curiosity with regard to historical cartography led me to note that some legends that involve hidden treasure or relics seem to include the theme of Arcadia as part of the imagery presented to the seeker. The next two places of Arcadian mystery include Oak Island, Nova Scotia, and Colonial Virginia. Both places are home to interesting stories of lost treasure or relics. The Oak Island treasure is one of the most famous treasure stories of all time. The land of Nova Scotia was named Acadia by French interests, which is their spelling and pronunciation of Arcadia. Strangely, many of the things related to Nova Scotia and the Oak Island money pit may lead us to concepts important to American history, which will surprise many people. We will examine a literary work by Philip Sidney entitled Arcadia that is associated both with Nova Scotia and the demise of King Charles I of England and Scotland. An examination of the literary work Arcadia by Philip Sidney may reveal many strange aspects to the history of Nova Scotia and the United States, as well as aspects of the Oak Island treasure legend itself. One of the most important aspects of Philip Sidney's Arcadia is that King Charles I's last words were said to be from a portion of the book known as Pamela's Prayer. This is really interesting and will fit in with the involvement of the Stuart family in all of the Arcadian mysteries, and will also link later to Shugborough Hall and Admiral Anson's Moor Park estate and the art and imagery there, where replicas of the Tower of the Winds are present at both estates. So the fact that Charles I's last words were also from Philip Sidney's Arcadia will be terribly interesting in what is about to be revealed in relation to Arcadia and Nova Scotia. The French name for Nova Scotia is Acadia, which translates to Arcadia. The text of Arcadia includes a story that is very similar to the original folklore of Oak Island. The story tells of a servant sent to recover a treasure stashed in a pit that has already been discovered, thus matching the original story of how the money pit was found by three young men. In Sidney's Arcadia, the servant Demetus is sent to find the treasure, which had already been found by one of the protagonists of the story, Doris. Upon finding the oak tree, Demetus finds a depression beneath it, which Doris had told him was a great treasure. He finds a depression in the ground, which is covered by flagstones at a shallow depth. The story describes the removal of logs and signs that the pit had been excavated prior to Demetus's labors. At the bottom of the pit, he finds an inscribed stone that tells of a vault beneath. After Demetus labors for hours, he finally removes the stone, only to find a parchment that contains a message telling him he had been sent on a fool's errand. The original folklore story of the money pit describes a very similar tale. The three young men remove flagstones that are in a depression beneath an oak tree located on Oak Island. They encounter layers of logs every 10 feet until they excavate to 90 feet. At that time, they were said to have found an inscribed and coated stone, thus matching in many ways the story from Sidney's Arcadia from 200 years prior. This story includes the fact that the pit soon floods, frustrating their efforts to find the treasure they know is still there. Amazingly, an examination of Philip Sidney's Arcadia in tandem with aspects of his life may indicate that the more modern tale of the Oak Island Money Pit was indeed based on the fictional work in Arcadia. In many ways, these similarities suggest that there is no treasure in the Money Pit. Sidney was said to have finished Arcadia by 1580, over 200 years before the three young men found the Money Pit on Oak Island. To answer the question of the relationship between this work of fiction and the Money Pit, we may also examine the life and literary work of William Alexander, the first Earl of Stirling in Scotland. William Alexander was also the first Baron of Nova Scotia and had the right to award baronetcies of Nova Scotia. He also sent one of his sons, William Alexander the Younger, to govern Nova Scotia in one of the early attempts at a Scottish colony there. William Alexander is said to have been one of the earliest speculative Freemasons to set foot in what is today Nova Scotia in Canada. William Alexander was from a family group that was closely related to the Stuart kings, James I, Charles I, Charles II, and later James II. William Alexander was even said to have been the tutor to the future King Charles II. During his life, he was known as a great writer in the post-Elizabethan period. In fact, William Alexander had later edited and amended Philip Sidney's work, Arcadia. Here, the governor of Arcadia had actually taken part in amending the same literary work that seems to include the original Money Pit story. All of this is terribly interesting in that it had been the French who had named Nova Scotia Acadia, or in other words, Arcadia. As it turns out, William Alexander was also directly related to Charles de La Tour, the first French governor of Nova Scotia. This may also explain why Charles de La Tour and his father Claude were both awarded baronetcies of Nova Scotia, which they both eventually accepted. It seems that no matter who ruled Nova Scotia in this back and forth between the French and English in owning Nova Scotia, that William Alexander would have a family member there. This may be evidenced as true as a member of the Alexander family named Alexander Alexander, which is common to use both names in that family, is noted as living in New Ross, Nova Scotia in 1637, after the time the French had regained Nova Scotia from the Scottish Alexander family. This is all even more amazing as we see this story unfold. The De La Tour family seems to be present in each Arcadian mystery, from Rennes-le-Chateau to even the Beale treasure and legend of Bacon's vault in Williamsburg. So they have some amazing associations, as their name even literally means of the tower, and we are seeing these towers involved in each mystery that literally serve as a definition of time and space in relation to the clues left in the mystery, according to my theories. If we assume that the treasure story in Sidney's Arcadia did serve as the template for the Money Pit saga, then we may suspect that all of this was a kind of setup that evoked the imagery from literature that had a symbolic connection to Nova Scotia. In many ways, it does make sense that there is no treasure there, and that there is a great more to be told at Oak Island than simply a treasure tale. Thank you for joining me here on part one of the Arcadian Mysteries Revealed with Cort Lindahl. Next time, we're going to look at the possibilities of a real treasure being at Oak Island and Philip Sidney's association with Sir Francis Drake that could make this a reality. So thank you for joining me now. Later, we'll also be covering how all of this connects to American history and General William Alexander of the Continental Army, who is actually directly descendant of Sir William Alexander of Stirling, the first Baron of Nova Scotia. And this American William Alexander, in fact, returned to Scotland in an attempt to regain his title, the Earl of Stirling, prior to the Revolutionary War. So that's very interesting in the context of Oak Island and many of the theories that espouse some sort of Jacobite connection to the mystery. Thank you very much for joining me. Join me again for part two coming up soon. If you'd like to see more of this in detail, check out my book, The Arcadian Mystery of Oak Island, Shugborough Hall, and Rennes-le-Chateau Revealed, available at createspace.com. And there's links to all that on my blog, survivalcell.blogspot.com. That also includes articles and stories related to what I'm talking about here and excerpts from my book. So thanks for joining me. Stay tuned for more coming up soon.